would not be a part, you know, the right way to address the committee, that the attribute to be a personal address.
Thank you. Council Blakely raised quite a considerable number of comments in terms of officers' comments, as you were down on the pre-application comments, and also regarding the artefacts. I'm just wondering if we could get some comments in relation to that, please.
Thank you, through you, Chair. It's not unusual when a pre-application is submitted that it's submitted without the benefit of the supporting information and is very often sent in to accompany a planning application. So when a planning application comes in, there is very often a lot more detailed work that has been carried out, often on the basis of the reply that has been given at the pre-application stage. So when Sheila gave her pre-application advice, that would have been on the basis of without the benefit of the supporting information that has been submitted with this planning application. And at that time, she felt that in the absence of the information that has been submitted with this application, that the council would be unlikely to support an application on the basis of what was submitted at pre-application stage. But as I say, when this came forward as a formal planning application, a lot more detailed studies have been carried out. A lot more information was submitted with that application, and pre-application advice is very clearly given, which doesn't commit the local authority to the determination of a planning application. In terms of archaeological information, that came forward as part of a representation by a local resident. The council sought the advice of our Merseyside Environmental Advisory Service, who also hold the historic environment record. And as part of that response from MIAS, the details of which I think are shown on the bottom of page 60 and the top of page 61, MIAS concluded that it is unlikely that there are any archaeological remains on the site. But on the basis of there being no archaeological remains within close proximity of the site, we have attached a condition that suggests a watching brief as development proceeds, if it's approved, just to make sure that any artefacts that are found on site are recorded properly.
Thank you. David, could I ask you to speak regarding the independent advisor, please?
Yes, thank you, Chair. When the committee last considered the fire station application, there were a number of detailed questions that were asked about response times, which as planning officers we weren't able to fully answer because that's not our area of expertise. So when I did the briefing with members for this committee a couple of days ago, I asked whether they thought, if those questions came up again from members of the committee, they would have enough expertise around the table for us as officers to be able to provide you with all of that information so you can make a fully informed decision. There was a discussion about that. There were some views that there was sufficient, there were some views that there wasn't sufficient information, if those questions should be raised by members. So what we did look at was whether or not we should support the work of your officers this evening with an expert who could respond in a detailed technical way to the response time questions if they came up. We believe that that expertise really lies with an operational fire service, because obviously they're operating response times and doing detailed runs and so on every day. And we did suggest that the Chief Fire Officer of Cheshire would be available to support the committee if they felt they needed it, but it would only be here on a factual basis to answer specific questions in relation to response times only. He would not be here to answer any other questions around highway issues or any planning issues or anything like that. That was discussed and put forward. There was then a further range of discussions and further information became available. I had conversations with the party spokespersons and the chair of the committee, and we formed a view which I discussed and agreed with the chair that given the information we now had and what we had in the report, that we would have the capability to answer any of those questions this evening should they arise. So on that basis, the chair took a decision with me that we would not have that expert witness here this evening.
Thank you, David. I think it's also been very helpful that all parties to this application, those for and against, have been able to speak this evening. So I'm glad that was that happened this evening. Just in terms of pages 54 to 56, which outline the number of sites which were offered to the fire brigade, some of which they say they did try to contact but were unable to, which I accept. But perhaps you can highlight to us, David, why the Grimsby Library site was withdrawn by the council.
My understanding there was that the Greasby site was identified as a potential location for the new fire station. There was a lot of local opposition to the use of that.
If you could let the officer speak, please.
There was a lot of local opposition to putting a fire station on that site, aligned with the health centre and the community centre, and the council then took a view that that site then would no longer be available for the fire station.
Thank you. My final question, please, to know, and then I'm going to put it to the committee. This is for the highway network and the service road issues that have been raised. If we could just have a few, if you could just comment on the highway network and also the service road
into the site, please. Thank you, Freedom Chair. In terms of the service road, my understanding is there will be one access into the site which would go past the car park, and obviously the visitors and staff would use that access. Also, the fire engines would access the site via that, would go around the back and then into the back of the car parking area for the fire engine, and would exit onto Saughall Massie Road from the front of that one. So it's essentially two accesses, but one's primarily for general traffic and the other one's the exit for the fire engine. In terms of our local network, the volume of traffic that's likely to be generated by this type of development is minimal when compared to the existing traffic that's on the network. So in terms of the impact, it's going to be negligible, negligible impact on the existing.
Can I just ask a supplementary question regarding the service room? Is that going to be set lower than it currently is?
There is no, obviously there's no service room there at the moment, but my understanding from the presentation is that it'll be about 200 millimetres lower at the front, going to about two or three metres lower than that. So there is a need to take some material away from the site and to level it out. So it will be set lower at the back than it will at the front.
Thank you, Keith. I will now open this up here.
Thank you, Chair. Can you hear me? Can I begin by saying I fully expected Grenfell to be used as an example tonight, simply because of the nature of that fire. I didn't expect it to be used by the chief fire officer of this borough. What I will say, Chair, as from anybody who uses that as an example to justify this application, I found quite abhorrent.
Yes.
I would remind cause and the nature of that fire and whether the fire services responses contributed or assisted to the result of that fire. And so to use that as evidence, I think we should discount that as a committee. Certainly, Chair, if any senior public servant, with the emphasis on senior public servant, tries to use scare tactics, threat or intimidation to this planning committee, it certainly turns me off, whatever the rest of the merits of that planning process.
Saving lives. So response times is absolutely critical to this application.